No,
first.
cut action.
Cross Lake, Manitoba, home to the Pimichakamak. Last winter, 5 young people in this community killed themselves. In the weeks that followed, 140 more attempted suicide.
We have a situation here.
Cross Lake declared a state of emergency.
The thought that somebody is out there is thinking of suicide and is contemplating it, that's what keeps me up at night.
We came to Cross Lake to hear from the young people. We gave them cameras and kept coming back for almost a year.
This is where I live.
We arrived expecting darkness, and we found it.
I want to die so bad. Nobody knows how much I want to take my own life.
But over the months, we also found hope.
This is my home. No matter where I end up in life, I'll always come back to Cross Lake.
Tonight, the young people of Cross Lake tell their stories. It's September. At Cross Lake's Mikisew High School, a new start. In a place still haunted by last winter's suicides.
Go to your block A, please. Good morning. Go.
Morning. It affected me. Oh my goodness. I knew all of them. I taught them.
Hopester, we need to talk after, okay?
I have 500 students. I worry about them. We don't want to lose another student.
Okay, you guys, let's go.
My name is Anna McKay. I'm the high school principal of Mikisew School, and I live in Cross Lake.
Anna has a big job. Since the crisis, 149 kids in this community have been deemed at risk for suicide and are now on a watch list. It's day 2, and by lunchtime, there's already an emergency.
He went down the hall playing loud music, and I stopped him. Please turn off your music or wear earphones. Then he turned around, school sex anyway, and he started swearing and ran out the door.
One of the kids on the watch list has gone missing.
Where is he? Okay, you tell him to come back here.
He's going to do something.
Yeah.
If he doesn't come, I have to phone somebody, okay? Took off again. He's over there. He doesn't want to come.
Yeah. She stopped him. He turned around and stormed out and said, "School sex anyway, fuck school." And then, as he was walking out this door, main door, he said, "I'm gonna go kill myself." Okay.
This is Anna. We have a situation here that one student took off and said that he's gonna do something to himself. And yeah, this happened before.
I'm nervous. Mm-hmm. I get like this when something like this happens.
Hi again.
Hey.
Guys, I have a situation here.
The missing boy has a history of threatening harm, and after last winter's suicides, no one is taking any chances.
I don't know what to expect right now. I'm scared, yeah.
A half hour later, police find the boy hiding in the woods. He's handcuffed for his own protection.
Not even a week of school.
The protocol now is to have him assessed by a mental health professional.
Hi, everyone. There's a student that's going to the nursing station to be assessed. I had to call the RCMP and the safety officers because she took off again.
This is the reality in Cross Lake. Even after declaring a state of emergency, there is no therapist permanently here. The boy will be flown to Winnipeg for further assessment, 500 kilometers away. The school struggles to be a stabilizing force. For many of the students, one of the few they know.
Who's feeling brave without a calculator? What is 1 divided by 10?
0.10.
Christian has been in and out of school for years. He's in grade 9 for the 5th time.
You can divide.
I'm Christian Bailey. I'm 17 years old. I want to be a hero someday, and I'm from Cross Lake.
My friends call me Dude or Chris Dude. This is where I live.
Christian is a complex kid. Yeah. On the outside, he's full of fun and bravado. When we gave him the camera, he was pretty excited.
This is my homie, Morgan, and here we are chilling. This is my bro, Thaddeus.
I was planning on doing a movie of my own, like The Life of Christian or something.
But the life of Christian isn't always a happy one, especially at home.
They drink a lot, and whenever my parents drink, my brother will drink too, and it's like, hurts to see my brother want to just grow up to being like them.
So there's a lot of sadness in the house.
Yeah, a lot of sadness, depression, and anger. Like, everyone's miserable in that house. They can't even keep it steady.
So how do you cope with it?
Music, friends, and weights.
All right, this is take 3. This is bench. And triceps, so.
For Christian, it's all good escape. But like many kids here, he dreams of escaping the reserve for good.
If you fight long enough, you will feel like a bird, you will feel free. Must be like the best feeling in the world. Wherever you want to go. No one's going to stop you from going there. Just feel free.
Do you want to get out of Cross Lake?
Yeah.
Where do you want to go?
Rio de Janeiro.
I grew up around people teaching me how to fight, how to smoke, what alcohol is, before I was even 10.
My name is Maxine Munoz. I'm a 15-year-old high school student, and I live in Cross Lake.
Maxine is in grade 10. She's been in and out of school, too. She's also been in trouble with the police for fighting.
I would always be mad. I'd always hit the walls, hit the doors, slam the doors, swear at my mom, at my sister, steal from them.
What are you angry about?
I don't know, just mad at everything. Everything that's happening, everything I've been through in my life. I dropped out of school. I started to drink. I didn't want to be in Cross Lake. I tried hard to leave this place, move out of here.
The suicides weigh heavily on everyone here. Everybody knew the kids who died. And even those not deemed to be at risk have been affected.
I'm Vince Gil Scott. I'm 18 years old. I want to be a pro athlete. I live in Cross Lake. I'm starting to get noticed around Canada, and pretty soon people around the world are gonna know who I am.
Vince Gill's plan was always to use sports as a way out of Cross Lake. But the suicides have shaken everything.
How did that affect young people in this town?
All these people thought they can just get away from their problems. But then they're just putting their problems on other people.
You knew these kids?
Yep. I know a lot of people that almost had tried killing themselves.
One of them was his close friend.
He came to me with a rope braid on his neck. I told him that, what about us, man? What about the people that care about you, man? Like we're gonna miss you too. We love you, man. We don't want you to leave us like that.
I thought that somebody is out there is thinking of suicide and is contemplating it, and that we don't know who it is. That's what keeps me up at night.
My name is Ron LePage. I am a suicide prevention worker, and I live here in Cross Lake.
The kids will say that they don't feel that they're appreciated. I hear a lot of nobody cares anyway, nobody loves me anyway.
What do you think when you hear that from a child?
I think they're broken. I think their hearts are broken.
Ron is a family counselor, not a mental health therapist. In the aftermath of the crisis, Cross Lake was promised two new full-time therapists, but not enough money to pay for them. And so they get by with part-timers who rotate in.
It upsets me that we are not cared for or seen as important. If it was in the white community, how it would be there. And yes, it does make me angry. But anger is not going to get me anywhere. I just go on every day trying to help the youth, trying to help people that are thinking of suicide.
The Pimicikamak people haven't always been so troubled. For generations, this Cree nation lived proudly and sustainably off traditional lands. But then in the 60s, a decision by Manitoba Hydro, dams were built, and huge swaths of that land disappeared underwater.
Because of the flooding, the destruction of the land, it will never ever go back to the way it was.
Dancy, I'm Chief Kathy Merrick of Pimicikamak Okamawin, the Cross Lake Band of Indians.
At the time, Cross Lake was told the dams would bring prosperity, jobs, but it didn't happen. The rising water destroyed hunting and fishing here. Today, nearly half of Cross Lake's households have no clean drinking water.
What did it do to your people?
It took away from them how they lived off the land. It destroyed their spirit. It destroyed who they were and what they had, and the promises were never fulfilled.
It's Saturday afternoon, and Christian is babysitting. His parents aren't at home. They were drinking all night, leaving him to watch over a bunch of neighborhood kids, including his 12-year-old sister, Kira.
Kind of like let them do what they want, and when after they're done, I tell them to clean up.
Tell me about your family.
They're nice, but they drink a lot.
This has been the reality in your life for how long?
As long as I can remember, since I was just a little kid. They would go drinking, and me and my brother would go from bar to bar, house party to house party, looking for them. Me and my brother loved their parents so much that we wanted to follow them every step of the way. But
I guess they didn't want to see us grow every step of the way. I'm not ashamed of who I am, where I come from. But I love them, but my family is just the problems that they have, they don't realize that they're giving us problems.
The stories are hard to hear, but they're shared willingly, almost eagerly. Clearly, they're stories they need to share.
I always think about killing myself. Like, I want to die so bad. Nobody knows how much I want to take my own life. Nobody knows how much I want to leave this earth. How much I want to stop breathing.
At 15, Maxine has tried to kill herself 4 times, the first time she was still in grade school.
When I lost my uncle to alcohol, I hung myself when I was 9 years old.
And what did you do?
The rope broke.
Her last suicide attempt was last spring. She was mourning her friend who did die.
I hung myself in my room. And I locked the door. But my mom broke my door to get me down. I was so close to killing myself. If it wasn't for my mom, I wouldn't have been here right now. I would have been in my coffin.
Impulse can become tragedy so quickly here. The first suicide last winter was 21-year-old Anita Skatch, a girl who struggled with all of Crosslake's problems, foster care, alcohol. When she took her life, she was homeless.
It was pretty hard for her.
Do you know what happened?
I wish I knew, honestly. Would have helped her. She was a good person too.
I'm Tanera McKay. I'm 24 years old and I'm from Cross Lake.
She was my friend. I grew up with her. Everybody was happy for her when she graduated. There was people that doubted her, but she finished. She was really proud of herself.
What happened?
She just, I don't know. She probably got sick of going home to home, not having a stable home. That's what she always wanted.
The housing crisis is chronic and growing and completely dependent on funding from the federal government. Hundreds of new homes are needed. Last year, Ottawa gave Crosslake enough money to build just 12. This is how crowded it can get. Tanera, her 3 children, her partner, her 2 brothers and their partners all live with her parents. three generations under one roof.
I know I'm not the only one that's needing a house. There's other families out there in the community that need housing. And I'm pretty sure there's more than 11 people in one house.
Tanara has been on the waiting list since her first daughter was born 6 years ago.
Sometimes it just gets hard. I just need to have my own privacy with my kid, my kids, my partner. But it's hard living in this house with 11 people in it.
I hear the stories, and I feel for them. They come into my office and they cry. And out of despair and out of not being able to have their own home. And all I can do is listen. It makes me angry at the government. The whole systematic of being a treaty Indian was to be able to provide for our people.
Soon, Tanara's house will be even more crowded. She's expecting again. But this baby, not even born, has already been life-changing. After her friend Anita died, Tanara spiraled into darkness too.
I had ideas like that too. I thought about it a lot of times. I thought about it every day, every night. I prayed to God to give me a message, to give me a sign. What's my reason to live? What's my reason to go on? And then, and a few weeks later, I found out I was carrying. And that changed my life around.
A four-hour drive from Cross Lake is the town of the Paw.
What is your name?
Vince.
Vince. Oh, Vince Scott?
Yeah.
Where do you live?
Cross Lake.
Vince Gill has come looking for a place on the town's Junior A hockey team. If he makes it, he'll move here. But competition is going to be stiff.
They want to use hockey to see different places, to go to places I've never been before. I would like to go play and I'm playing the NHL. But I'm chasing smaller goals right now before I chase that one.
No one understands the stakes better than his dad, Vince Sr.
He's really destined to be what he wants to be as a hockey player.
I don't believe in myself that I can accomplish these goals, but I just want to make my dad proud.
Vince Sr. once had his own hockey dreams, but then Cross Lake's problems caught up with him too. For years, he was an alcoholic.
The hardest thing I did was when I quit drinking. I changed my ways a full 360. That was so hard, I'll tell you that. But the only reason why I did it for my kids and for myself, first and foremost. Because if I hadn't changed my ways, I would have been 6 feet underground. That's why I don't want Vince Gill to follow my footsteps in that part. That's why I want to put that part away.
So you don't want Vince to have your life?
No, I don't want Vince to have my life. I told my son to be strong. Every day I tell him, my son, you gotta be strong.
2 weeks before her due date, Tanera is doing what every mom-to-be in Cross Lake must do: leave her home and her family to have her baby in Thompson, 3 hours away.
I feel happy that I'm gonna be leaving to go have my baby. At the same time, I feel sad because I have to leave my other ones. Yeah. I don't know, mixed emotions.
Come here, come hug me. Listen to Dad, okay? Kiss. Kiss, Mom. Bye. Love you. Bye.
Bye. Bye. This will be the longest I've left them. It's gonna be lonely.
What's the hardest part of it?
When you call home and they're crying for you, it's pretty hard. I love being a mom to my kids. They're a world to me. Like, my life is just about my kids now. There was times too I ran off to alcohol, but I know that it wasn't the answer. I want to make it better for my kids. Like, that's what I want to change to. Like, I don't want my kids to see me like that ever.
Babies are a powerful force here.
I felt like embarrassed of being pregnant at the age of 14. I felt like people were looking at me like, you know, like, she's pregnant already.
You got it.
Maxine has an 18-month-old son. A teenage pregnancy might be cause for concern in a lot of places, but here it's not unusual. Besides, it's this baby who's given the girl who wanted to die the will to keep going.
Like, I can't leave him. I can't leave him here to think, like, why did my mom do that? She probably didn't want me. She probably didn't love me. I don't want my kid to grow up like that. I'm wondering why I'm gone.
Why are you looking at me like that? What did I do? Huh? Don't look at me like that. You're giving me the look, boy.
He'd probably think, like, I didn't want him. But he's the one that's still keeping me together to this day.
I had a good day at school today. I made a new friend, so I'm just thinking positive now.
Going back to school after a year away was a big step for Maxine. It's not easy juggling motherhood and studies, but she's motivated.
Gonna try to finish school and get a better life for me and my son.
Back in the paw, it's decision day. The day Vince Gill will learn whether he's made the team or not.
This guy will go in, shoot this net, picks up this forward here. Just 1-0, 2-0, a little bit of flow, a little bit of skating, okay? Full speed, fellas, full speed.
Now, I'm not too sure if I'm gonna go make it, but I'm just gonna keep going hard though.
But it's not going to happen. Not this year.
Hey, Vince. How you doing, buddy? Have a seat. You got some good skill. Skating's got to get a little bit stronger, but that comes with getting stronger as you get older, right?
Yeah. We'll definitely keep track of you wherever you play this year.
Want me to work on my upper body strength and my leg strength.
Okay.
Get my compete level higher.
Okay, right on. That's good.
It's hard to say who's more disappointed, but Vince Sr. assures him there'll be other chances. For now, though, it's back to Cross Lake. In September, Tanara gave birth to a son. She named him Austin.
Just when I thought my whole world was crashing down, you know, he came. Like, it's amazing. I'm just glad he did.
A month later, he was christened, welcomed into the church.
Austin William Johnson McKay, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May the Lord bless you and keep you.
For Tanara and for her family, it was a proud moment. But it is one of the big disconnects here. The enduring influence of an institution that for generations did so much damage to Indigenous people, including the people of Cross Lake.
The residential school had a great impact in my community. A lot of our older people were taken from their homes, were placed there.
It took away the parenting from Aboriginal people. It took away what they knew how to do. They knew how to take care of their children. They knew how to be parents, but they were told by someone else that they didn't know how to do it.
The showing of love that was taken away from parents in the schools. The speaking of their language was taken away from them in the schools. Their identity as Aboriginal people was taken away from them in the schools.
There was also abuse, emotional, physical, and sexual.
Our people were raped by the nuns and the preachers that were there. So even now, today, it's still there where a young child gets sexually abused by a relative in the same home.
Christian says he was sexually abused as a child.
It's just hard growing up the way I did. And they would drink. And people would come in the room and do things to me.
What did they do?
They would touch me in places I wouldn't even want to be touched.
These were friends of your parents, or people that were in the house when they were drinking?
Well, back then, if you had alcohol, you were allowed to party in there, so. So six or seven people that did that to me. It kind of messed me up in school.
He also thought of suicide, and he told no one.
I didn't want, to live with other people.
You were afraid they would take you away if you told them the truth. Why do you stay there, Christian? Why do you stay in that house?
My sister, I don't want her to go through the same thing I did. I already feel like a parent. And it's kind of my number one job, so I gotta look after.
Well, with a soul.
Cross Lake is policed by the RCMP and by the band's own security team, including Assistant Chief Safety Officer Mike Omond.
Most of our calls are alcohol related in one way or another. Either the person came there drunk or some person is drinking in the house or having a house party. All the violence, all the fighting that happens is people that are drunk.
On this night, it's two brothers who've been drinking. The call came from their elderly mother, worried for everyone's safety.
We're going to take these. We're going to go log them in with the RCMP. When we take the, we're going to take both those guys in. Technically, we are a dry reserve. People just do it. They don't care. You know, they'd rather drink.
The reserve made the decision to go dry to ban alcohol sales more than 30 years ago. The trouble is, Cross Lake, the reserve, is adjacent to the municipality of Cross Lake, a town under provincial administration.
We're driving on the community side now.
And there is a vendor with a license.
It's a filthy place, and they're serving people there that are already drunk and that shouldn't even be in the place. We've gone to the province, we've done a lot of work to withdraw the license.
What does the province say when you go to them and say, this is hurting my people?
They say, well, we hear no complaints and whatnot. I said, well, I'm complaining to you. I'm telling you what's happening in my community.
But her complaints haven't changed anything.
See this bush area right here, but that's where they would hang out, drink right there, or along the fence.
Addiction, poverty, suicide, the diseases of despair have always been too prevalent here. But now the victims are getting younger. It's December, almost a year since the crisis began, and there's been another suicide. The 25-year-old, a young woman, had recently moved away from Cross Lake. Her body now returned to her people for burial.
The crisis isn't over, and it won't be over till the day that people start talking about it, about the suicide, and the day where our people are happy, our young people.
It's 4 months since we first met Christian, and he's trying hard to be happy, despite his troubles. One of his greatest influences, someone who sees great potential in him, is Ron.
I can see Christian as a leader. I see a really loving person that loves the community, that loves his friends, that loves people, and I think he's also one of the kids that is struggling to better himself, that is struggling to see that he is responsible for who he is and who he becomes.
Christian knows if he's going to get through school, he needs more stability in his life. And so he decides the only way to get it is to move out of his home and in with his aunt.
Well, it's better than where I was staying at my mom's because they don't drink there. And there's something to do there.
I gotta check out my sister out of that house, and the only way is by getting a job and getting my education. And that way I can take her away and she'll have a better life.
So much weight on such young shoulders. One person who seems to have things under control is Vince Gill. He's over the disappointment of not making the hockey team, and he now has a new passion in life, 16-year-old Kendry.
Pretty sure I'm passing all my classes right now. I'm gonna try to keep it like that. Try to stay consistent in my classes.
Vince Gill, Scott, please report to the office.
But something's up.
There you are. You were here all day?
Vince Gill, the kid no one thought they had to worry about, has been skipping classes.
Oh, because we had you down for that positive peer culture. Positive peer culture.
I didn't know what time. I thought that was after
this
school.
Morning. No. So you're going to be here tomorrow?
What time?
I'm going to check and see if I can get you in the morning. Block, what is that, block D? Yeah. All right. Are you coping okay?
How are you?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Are you?
Is there something bothering you?
Yeah, but I don't know how to talk about it right now.
Christian has been missing school too. His resolve to double down and finally get through grade 9 seems to be slipping.
Get easily distracted. It's hard to stay focused. Well, I've been drinking a bit and getting high.
Why?
I just feel something.
To feel something?
Yeah, just to have a feeling.
What time did you get here?
Around 10:30.
Why?
Because I slept in.
Where did you sleep?
At Tim's. Yeah. Because I forgot to set my alarm clock.
You look after yourself more or less, eh?
Yeah.
And you wake yourself up. Well, that's good you're doing that. But you need to do. You need to get up earlier. Okay? Because you're missing some important contact time with the teachers. I told him, like every student, you need to have good marks, you need to be in school. And he's been doing that. He's really trying.
Maxine has been trying too, but being a mom and a student is taking a toll.
Today was good, I guess. I'm kind of confused at my life right now. I'm tired of acting happy all the time. Like nothing's bugging me. Having a big smile on my face every day when people see me. I'm tired of hiding everything.
Shortly after she recorded that, Maxine's Facebook post got very dark again.
What if I told you I wanted to die, that I'm tired of living, of being alive? What if I said it gets worse at nights, the thoughts get louder and nothing is right? I was thinking about suicide, thinking I was gonna do it today, that day. I don't know, me and my boyfriend were like trying to break up. Like I was just feeling so sad. Sometimes I feel like suicide is the only way out, but I know it's not worth it.
Back at school, the concern about Vince Gill isn't going away.
Sometimes when we do look for him, he's not here, he's not in the building. And I know for a fact that his girlfriend looks for him, goes to look for him to come to school. I think he's a potential grad, and I hope he graduates.
But Anna knows Vince Gill has a secret.
It's heavy for him right now, and I know what's going on with him right now in that sense. He needs to, I don't know, own up to it and be responsible for it.
A few weeks later, all is revealed. Vince Gill and Kendry are about to become parents to twins.
Can you go first?
No, cut. Action.
Can you go first?
I was happy and excited, and kind of scared at the same time. Mostly nervous about how it's gonna go.
My turn?
Yeah.
I was shocked that I was scared and happy. Not surprised, though.
I was surprised. Can't wait to be a parent. One of the things I was waiting for, but I didn't expect it to be this early, but still happy, and I can't wait to be a daddy.
What he said, I wasn't expecting it to be this early for me. I had a plan to get married to him, then have babies, and then move into a house.
I had mixed emotions.
What?
Because of my my baby so young, eh? So young to be a father. Like I'm still fathering him, and you know. And when they showed me the pictures, when they told me what twins, then I went happy, you know. So I can't wait to meet them now. But still, on the other hand, it's still be hard for them. You wouldn't be, like I told him, you wouldn't be playing hockey. You wouldn't be able to leave to go play after he graduates. But now, dreams are shattered, I said. Because you're going to have to take care of these babies. You can't abandon them. Yeah.
Cross Lake declared its suicide emergency in part to get noticed, and for a while it did. Teachers from Toronto were so moved, they volunteered to come to the high school to conduct a leadership training course, organized by Anna.
When someone talks about issues that you have, you talk about the good things, you talk about whatever's on your mind, really.
I want them to open up. I want them to tell what's going on. They need to let it out. They need to bring it out. They need to express themselves.
The school also got special funding, 2 extra support workers for a year. But the year is up, and it's not clear they'll be extended, which only means more pressure on the community workers who are starting to burn out.
Ron, I can hear your cowboy boots. Get over here.
Ron, who's been doing suicide prevention on top of his regular job, has come to tell Anna he's stepping back for a bit.
But they request you, Ron.
No, they don't request me. They're requesting for help. It should be Janice that's coming in.
But what do I say then when they say I want to speak to Ron?
Well, Ron doesn't do this anymore.
You know that's how they are. You know, they say, well, the only person I want to talk to is Ron.
But then that's where we have to figure out, like, who's going to do it, because I'm backing off for now. I can't do both.
It takes a toll on you, eh? It does. You need to step away from it for your own benefit.
Run!
Hey.
But he'll be back. He's very compassionate about the youth. He wouldn't abandon them. He'll come back.
More than a year after the suicides that launched this community's crisis, not much has changed in Cross Lake. Promises of help have been partially kept, but already leaders can feel the country's attention waning. What that means for the kids at risk, what that means for the next generation of kids, are things that Chief Kathy Merrick can't think about without getting angry.
I'm angry because I feel like a beggar in my homeland. That's why I'm angry. And I shouldn't have to beg what my people should have in this country we call Canada. We ask for nothing over and above than any other Canadian would get. We ask nothing over and above than any other Manitoban would get. We just want the same standards that are provided to other people in this good country we call Canada. That's all I want. I don't want to beg no more.
After 5 years of trying, Christian finally passed grade 9 this winter. He also became an uncle, his brother's baby. New life has brought new peace to his parents' house, and he's spending more time here. His mother and his dad have promised to stop drinking.
Their family's showing that they're trying to change. They're actually putting effort to make a change, and that's why looking at them makes me want to like get everything together and try and make it farm life. Then like when I make it farm, I grab my sister and my brother and try like help out my parents too with some stuff.
Maxine has had a rocky year. She quit school again for a brief time, but she's now back. A breakup with her boyfriend, her baby's dad, prompted another crisis.
She said she lost everybody. She didn't lose everybody. I said, I'm still here.
She told me that I'm a good mother, that I can do this, told me to think about myself and my son. And she showed me a picture of a quote. Like, I woke up this morning and I said to myself that I don't want this anymore. And then at the end it said, it's my choice to change.
Kendry is off to Winnipeg for an ultrasound. The babies are due in May. Now that he's gotten over the shock of it all, Vince Gill can hardly contain himself.
Those are my kids, you know? And like they're gonna be half me and half the girl I love. That's what makes it even better.
His goal now is to graduate and if he can, find a job in Cross Lake. Dreams of a hockey career are something he'll have to pass on to the next generation, just like his father did.
It's not giving up, it's just passing on my dream to someone else. It's not giving up. Like, as long as I get to live, see my kids live my dream, I'm already living my dream, you know? Because that's me too, because they're my kids. Like, that's me with them. As long as they just keep them close to my heart, then I'll be living the dream with them.
As for Tanera, she and her partner also split up. She's raising her kids on her own now, but she's better equipped than she ever was. In January, she went back to school and will graduate in June. She's already applied for college.
We come back to you 2 years from now, or 5 years from now. Who's the Tanera we're going to meet then?
I don't know. I hope she's successful. I'd like her to be anything she can possibly could be, and just to keep moving forward in life. I feel like nothing can stop me now.
A year is a long time in a teenager's life. We came to Cross Lake because 149 teenagers were deemed to be at risk for suicide. There have been struggles this past year, moments of real darkness for some of them. But as of today, every one of those kids is safe and alive.
I want to get this out because what if somebody's going through the same thing out in the world? There's always a better way to settle things instead of suicide. There are things that are gonna come your way and knock you down, but it's your choice whether to get back up or not. No matter how dark your path is, there's always a little light shining at the end of it.
You have been watching a special edition of The Fifth Estate. If you want to know more about the people we met in Cross Lake and the stories they told us, go to our YouTube site. You'll see what it's like to live there, including in those crowded houses. 18 people live in this one, sleeping wherever they can. You'll also find portraits of those who opened their lives and their hearts to us during our many visits.
I love the way I feel today. I felt like I accomplished something.
And soon we'll be launching our new podcast series, The Secrets of the Fifth Estate. You'll be able to find them and so much more at our website. But for now, for everyone at the Fifth Estate, thanks for watching us this season. We'll look forward to seeing you again in the fall.